The following is a presentation made by British Mensa. This is the first of two videos. It was played to an audience of members of Mensa. And in part two, Patrick invites questions from the audience.
Good morning, or good afternoon. I do not know at what time you will listen to this talk. In this presentation, I would like to discuss the role of the interpreter in the context of the musical experience. I have an obvious interest in the subject. I am an interpreter, and in the last few years, I have spent some time thinking about what my job actually consists of. It is some of these thoughts I would like to share with you today. For reasons which have to do with time, I will limit myself to discuss the relationship of the interpreter with the composer. The relationship of an interpreter with his audience is a fascinating topic, but would need a whole hour to itself. To begin, I will state the obvious, which nonetheless has to be remarked upon. Interpreters occupy a unique place in the artistic world, one which is halfway between artistry and artisanship, between the creator and the servant. It is an ambiguous situation which has no parallel with the possible exception of the actor. This has something to do with the peculiarity of the art of music, which is the only art form in which the creator puts on the page something which is not the work of art itself, but only directions towards its realization. It is worth dwelling on this a little bit. It is as though a painter or a sculptor would leave more or less detailed plans about the work they envision, leaving the realization to artisans, who would each interpret the given instruction in their own way, inevitably imprinting their own personality on the final product. In some ways, this can appear distressing. It seems as though the interpreter will always stand in the way of the work he's interpreting. On the one hand, allowing the work to exist, on the other, preventing us from hearing it as it was conceived. The reason for this anomaly is that sound, unlike shape or color, is ephemeral. Once painted, a picture will remain in existence until time degrades it beyond repair, or until it gets destroyed. Music is, by comparison, so much more fragile, and yet in some ways it is indestructible, because it is reproducible. Once a painting is lost, we may know it for a copy or a photograph. It may have been captured on film, but the original, once lost, is lost forever. With music, this cannot happen because there is no original. And this is a paradox which is quite difficult to grasp. There is no Bach's Matthew Passion in the way there is a Night Watch, for example. Bach's Matthew Passion exists as a potentiality, which can be and is realized often in a multitude of ways. As long as it will find people to give it a voice, it will exist. And yet, though it will exist, and we will recognize it as Bach's Matthew Passion every time we hear it, it will never be twice the same, and the differences can be quite colossal. Listen to these two extracts from the opening, one by Klemperer, the other one by Paul McCrish. listening to these, one is tempted to ask the following question. Is there a point at which the Matthew Passion is no longer going to be the Matthew Passion? The two extracts you heard were pole apart from each other in a multitude of ways, yet we have no real difficulty identifying them as the same piece. So is it a case that the music exists in a platonic sense and can only be partially realized? Or is it that there is no such thing as an absolute rendition of a work, even on a theoretical level, and that a piece of music on the page is simply a pointer towards a realization which can be effected in a multitude of ways? But if so, are there ways of realizing the work which are more valid than others? And what does it mean for an interpretation to be valid? Does it mean an interpretation as faithful as possible to the wishes of the composer? Even this is not as simple as it sounds. There are many great interpretations that we know to be historically wrong, by which I mean that we can be pretty certain they would have puzzled the composer exceedingly. And yet, we do not hesitate to recognize them as great. I could name recordings like Glenn Gould's Goldberg Variations, Furt Wengler playing Beethoven Ninths, or Horowitz playing Scarlatti Sonatas. To begin answering these questions, we must start by trying to define the areas of constraints, which are the boundaries of the interpreter's world. This will, by contrast, enable us to understand the extent of the territory where his freedom lies, and therefore help us to define what is an interpretation. One has first to understand that the concept of the interpreter, as we understand it today, is actually a fairly recent development. Musicians used to be musicians. They could compose music, conduct it, play, and usually quite a few instruments. They needed to be versatile, and if they happened to be better at one of those things, it didn't mean that they had to let go of everything else. The specialization actually came in quite late, in a way which was proportionate to the lack of general public interest in contemporary music. There is probably no other society so concerned about preserving our past as much as ours is. We tend to assume that this has always been the case, but the evidence is against us. When the famous German violinist Joseph Joachim found the score of Mozart's Sinfonia Concertante in the second half of the 19th century, he was very eager to try it. He thought it was a lovely work, but the idea of playing it in public was not even considered an option. Up until the end of the 19th century, music was on the whole concerned with contemporary creation. The music of the past was more an object of study, of admiration perhaps, and if it was performed at all, it was done without any of the reference we feel towards it today. Works could be arranged, cut, or modernized to suit contemporary tastes. On the one hand, it is a very good thing of our society to preserve the treasures of its past. On the other, it is slightly unhealthy. The sheer burden it represents saps creativity or forces composers to write against the past, very much like an overbearing parent has to be symbolically killed by the child if he wants to have a meaningful life. Stemming from this sense of being the guardians of a tradition, we have developed the concept, which is relatively new, of fidelity to the score, or fidelity to the intentions of the composer. According to this, we try to abide by whatever the composer has chosen to write. This starts, simply, with the notes on the page. If Bach writes an F, I must play an F, otherwise I am actively disobeying his instructions. It is not sometimes quite as simple as this, but still it remains perhaps the most objective parameter we have. It is very much like an actor. The printed word must remain. Everything else, from the tone, the length of the silences, the speed of the enunciation, is a world of endless possibilities. But in music, we are more often than not given rather more instructions than actors ever are. The composer usually writes something about the dynamics, the tempo, the phrasing, and sometimes even more subtle parameters, like very small fluctuations in tempo, or which voice should be highlighted, which one should be kept in the background. But the general trend has been that the more we look back in time, the more freedom the interpreter seems to have been given by the composer. And the more we move forward in time, the more his freedom has been curtailed. In the Baroque period, a certain degree of cooperation was actually expected from the performer. It was taken for granted that he was to add his own ornaments and embellishments to the music he played, and more generally to contribute something to the score. It is also important to understand that composers were writing with little or no thoughts about the future. The idea that they might still be played 200 years later probably didn't really come into consideration at all. Writing for contemporaries, often musicians working in the same town under their direct instructions, they didn't jam-pack their scores with indications because they didn't feel they needed to. They could rely on the knowledge and understanding of their performers, a knowledge that can no longer be taken for granted. To this day, for example, there is still a misconception which says that since Bach didn't usually write tempo indications in his scores, it means you are free to choose your own tempo. This is actually not true. Bach didn't write his tempi because he didn't need to. People would be expected to know whether they were playing a sarabande or a jig or courante, or whether the piece had simply to be played in what was known as tempo ordinario, which was roughly based on the average human pulse. As a result of this mixture of freedom and assumed knowledge, Baroque composer scores tend to be fairly minimal. As we progress in time, we see that composers take more and more care to keep the interpreter's creativity in check. The reasons for it are twofold. Roughly dating from the French Revolution, composers started to think about their own posterity. With emancipation from patronage, they began writing the music they wanted to write, rather than the music they were asked to write. The more successful of them also had their music performed in places where they could have no input, and report came that the performances were sometimes quite far off from what the composer had intended. One of the first things to reflect that change of attitude was tempo. With the invention of the metronome in the early 19th century, we quickly see more and more composers adopt this way of telling interpreters what speed they had in mind. Because speed was always about the most elusive thing to convey to performers. Words like adagio or allegro are loose definitions, and composers like Beethoven longed for something more precise. Yet, even these, which should be a solid, reliable way to gauge the intended speed composer intended, have proved something of a disappointment. It appears that composers sometimes misjudge tempi for their own works. Sometimes, the history of interpretation shows that actually different tempi can have different effects on the piece, but that it is not possible to say one is valid and another is not, even if the composer has chosen one. Acoustical elements also play a part, and any performer will know that playing in a church or in a dry hall, on a modern or period instrument, are all things which are going to have a huge impact. In fact, to these days, metronome indications remain the parameter that interpreters are the most reluctant to take into account. Most of them, or most of us, don't even bother checking what the composer has written. And even the most precise of composers in that respect, people like Bartok, who goes as far as to indicate the exact duration of his works to the nearest second. You can find in Bartok's work 2 minutes and 37 seconds. In fact, as a performer in his recordings, it is easy to see that very often he is not in line with his own markings. When we move forward in time to the 20th century, we find that performers' freedom is being curtailed even further. There is, on the part of composers, a certain mistrust of the performer, who is increasingly viewed no longer as a partner in creation, but rather as a disturbing agent, a malfunctioning mirror inherently distorting everything he touches. Nothing can illustrate this point better than looking at composers' scores. If we take a page of music by Bach, we can see the notes and perhaps very little else. If I now show you a page of music by Chopin, you can see actually already quite a lot more. You see the notes, but you will see also tempo indication, pedal marking, phrasing, dynamics, all there to help the interpreter to understand better the intention of the composer. If we then move on to an early 20th century composer like Albéniz, we can see clearly a trend. Practically each note has its own dynamic marking, an indication of expression, to the point of the score being almost unreadable. In fact, many people and my Spanish teacher used to say it would be better if an edition came of Albéniz which contained just a note and nothing else, and we would intuitively do whatever he wants, rather than feeling we have to read absolutely every indication, which put weights on us as performers. His scores are unreadable. He does remain a fairly extreme and almost pathological case, so he helps me to make my argument clear. But it does remain that this kind of dictatorship would have been unthinkable only a few decades before. When Paul Wittgenstein was rebuffed by Ravel for his started-up version of the left-hand concerto, he told Ravel, "Well, interpreters are not slaves." Ravel's reply was blunt and to the point. Interpreters are slaves. So we can see that this strange ambiguity over the role of the interpreter is something that has at all time permeated the way he had been looked upon. And if we observe different interpretative trends in vogue in the 20th century, we will see this dichotomy about the role of the interpreter is being reflected. Of course, the limit of any exploration in the domain is brought by recordings. We have no certain way of knowing how people performed before the recording age. We have good reason to suspect that they would have played with a degree of freedom which would have been quite shocking to us. But the proof of this assumption will forever be out of reach. As I said, we tend today to imagine that the perfect interpreter is the one who doesn't project anything of his own personality into the music he plays, the pure mirror of the work of art. And it is on the surface a reasonable assumption. This was the ideal of someone like Sviatoslav Richter, arguably one of the greatest pianists that ever lived. Whenever he was questioned as to what he thought made the difference between him and others, he would reply, "I do what is written in the score." In his mind, this was equivalent to being faithful to the wishes of the composer and meant that his own personality would not come through. As it happens, he was in fact as idiosyncratic a musician as one can ever be. Everything he touched became Richter, and he's an extremely easy pianist to recognize on a blind test. Because he's such an extreme example of an attitude, it is worth staying with him for a little while. I can see two reasons which would explain his failure to be what he thought he was. The first one is about what I would have to call knowledge. The main problem of the interpreter is that he is often concerned with bringing back to life a music which belongs to another era, another culture, with different codes, different values that we can no longer take for granted, but which have profound repercussions on the way the music should be played. As we have seen, music notation has been a long quest for greater precision and accuracy, which implies that even assuming that it is now precise and accurate, which is questionable, it most certainly hasn't been for most of the period interpreters are dealing with. However, Richter had one of the most literal minds that ever existed. So he was indeed, and this is part of his genius, extremely good at doing what was written on the page. But partly because he was not what you might call an intellectual, partly because of the time and place he lived in, he had very little knowledge about what composers did not write. So when Richter plays Bach, it is compelling for many reasons. But if we can be certain of one thing, it is that he is very far from what Bach had in mind. And this in almost every respect. We may speculate as to whether Bach might have found it interesting nevertheless. But we do have the evidence to know that he's stylistically miles away. And this would be true for most of what he plays. The second reason why Richter fails in his endeavor to be a mirror of the composition he performs is that, like all of us, he has what Jung calls a shadow. We cannot be transparent because what makes our artistic personality is not merely our conscious choices. It is also, and perhaps mostly, what emerges from under the threshold of consciousness. In the case of Richter, the desire to glue himself to the written text represents the conscious attitude. And it is what you might call the veil of order in his playing. Scratch this and you will find quite a different and conflicting persona. There is in him a pronounced compulsion to look for extremes. Extremes of tempi first. If you listen to his famous recording of his playing of a Chopin etude, you can see that he is way above Chopin metronome markings, despite the fact that his metronome marking is already extremely fast. At the opposite end, listen to his opening of Schubert Sonata, D894, if I'm correct. An educated guess would tell us that his Schubert is probably played at roughly half the speed the composer had in mind. And if you listen to him playing the Beethoven Bagatelle Opus 126, number 4, you will see that there is a wild beast lurking in Richter. His passionate adherence to the written text clearly serves as a kind of protection against the chaotic forces in his nature. Though, as the Bagatelle might suggest, it does not always work. There are many times, particularly in concert recordings, where Richter fails his highest ideals and gets carried away by the force of his unconscious. He might, and in fact I think he has written about it, and we know that he resented this very much. But for us, listener, this tension between his conflicting artistic impulses is what makes him such an incomparable artist. Richter could be said to belong to a general trend of interpretation, which could be called objectivist, though in many ways he could also be described as a failed objectivist. Objectivism dominated the scene for many years, and to a certain extent still does today. At its best, it brought us some of the finest musicians of the second half of the 20th century. Musicians of immense subtlety, who could achieve a lot while seemingly doing very little. One of the finest specimens of this brand of performer is the Romanian pianist Clara Haskell. Like Richter, when asked by the conductor she was working with on a concerto how she envisioned the work, she would reply, "I do what is written on the score, that's all." Listen to her playing Mozart. It feels as though she is not doing anything, but don't be fooled. There is extraordinary subtlety in this understated playing. Unfortunately, the line is fine between doing something subtle and not doing anything at all. And a sad part of the legacy of objectivism are performers who are so afraid of leaving their mark on the work they play, or so afraid of not being stylistically accurate, that they end up doing nothing at all and leave us with interpretations which are not much more than empty shells. It has become quite common these days, and it is a genuine worry. It means that classical music is losing much of its vitality and that having been an object of reverence for so long, it is in danger of getting fossilized. At the other end of the spectrum, we find a type of interpreter whom we could call the Romantics, a brand of musicians who threatened to become extinct a little while ago when they were pretty much replaced by the Objectivists, but who might, by a natural swing of the pendulum, just be back in fashion. They fully embrace the idea of the performer's individuality, and they revel, consciously or not, in the friction created between their artistic personality and the ones of the composers. What they present is very much one possible, personal angle of view on a given work, which, if they are good musicians, can be fascinating. Their approach is characterized by the idea that the text is just the beginning, a sort of basic roadmap, but that it doesn't and cannot contain the essential. These people will be, as a rule, highly intuitive and would be able to play the same piece in many different ways, depending on the way the wind was blowing for them on that day. The question of faithfulness to the text, or even of stylistic coherence, is of little or no interest to them. They are direct heirs of a time where creation was mostly contemporary, and where, with the advent of the Romantic movement, freedom of expression was a highly prized value, where relying on one's feeling was thought to be the way to attain a form of authenticity. A very good example of this would be someone like Shura Cherkassky, a highly individual, whimsical musician. Like many of the Romantic, he could be slightly hit and miss, but the hits were so phenomenal that we would forgive many more misses for the sake of the magic he's capable of conjuring when he's on a good day. This kind of instability is often a characteristic of this category of performers. They take risks, they believe in inspiration more than in work. So they are at the mercy, more than others, of having a good or a bad day. Listen to Cherkassky on a good day, play Chopin's third etude, and you will have an idea of what a Romantic who is inspired is capable of conjuring. The 1960s brought up a new kind of performing movement, which we now familiarly call the HIP, short for Historically Informed Practice. At their best, these interpreters are an attempt to reconcile the Objectivists and the Romantics. Like the objectivists, they will have the desire to recreate as faithfully as possible the work as it has been intended. Yet they will try to gather as much knowledge as possible of the different historical side of playing, which will mean they won't fall into the trap of thinking that doing the text is a guarantee of a faithful interpretation. They will know that historically the interpreter had to be actively involved in the recreation of the work, but they will do it in accordance with the style of the time, which is something that the Romantic, by and large, were not really interested in. They have been hugely influential, and they have, in some respects, totally transformed our perception of works we thought we were familiar with. Of course, the problems with this is that historical knowledge can only take us so far into the proper understanding of the style of a period. At the end of the day, there is always going to be an awful lot of assumptions or educated guesses, which is not actually a bad thing because it keeps the movement alive. The worry about the HIP movement was that it could have dictated a finite way of performing a work. But this actually proved untrue. The HAP word is rife with conflicting schools as regard to pretty much every single parameter of interpretation, and if it does bring into question the authenticity of a lot of it, it is actually a very good thing, in that it fuels a creativity that would have been threatened by too much certainty. Listen to the opening of this bar cantata played in an old-school way by Karl Richter first, and then by Gardiner, one of the leading conductors of the HIP movement, and you will have some idea of how far this movement shook everything we ever took for granted. I may have given the impression that these categories are being hermetically sealed from one another. This is, of course, not the case. These are, at best, traits that help us to understand various types of performers. And had I had 2 hours instead of one, I could have gone into much more detailed and nuanced overview. But as it stands, what does this survey of the different kind of interpreters tell us? It seems to all point into one direction, which is that the interpreter mirror of the work of art is a chimera. It doesn't exist. Neither feeling, nor strict adherence to the printed text, nor even musicological knowledge seem to get us there. We might think that composers who are also performers will be able to settle the debates, at least regarding their own music. But actually, this turns out not to be the case either. The two best pianist performers of the 20th century were without a doubt Bartok and Rachmaninoff. They have performed their own music extensively, and as fascinating and informative as their performances might be, very few people would say that they represent the last word in terms of interpretation. There are just one possible interpretation. In fact, quite idiosyncratic and quite unexpected. Rachmaninoff, for example, whose music is so rich, some would even say decadent, turns out to be a robust, almost dry and very unsentimental pianist. Bartok, whose music is all edges and spikes, plays with a remarkable fluidity. It is as though the composers and the performers represent complementary sides of their whole persona. Let us push the reflection a step further. We have established that there are several types of interpreters, and that not all of them desire to be a blank canvas, and that the ones who do are more or less doomed to failure. So we must ask the question, what is interpretation, if it cannot ever be said to be an exact reflection of the composer's wishes? Well, it is generally agreed that music, or at least great music, is greater than what any performer can give with one performance. But it may be that great music is also greater than the man who put it on paper. The composer had an inspiration and has a technique. He wrote something down. But does it mean that what he heard was rigidly fixed in his mind? Nothing is less certain. One has only to have some personal experience of composition, or better, to have worked with a good contemporary composer, to see that the transition between what is written on the page and the actual oral experience is actually quite hazardous, fluid, and sometimes surprisingly open. This is because music works very much like a symbol in a dream, or a metaphor in a poem, if you like. It conveys a multiplicity, perhaps an infinity, of shades of possible meaning, which are all part of a greater whole, but music, unlike most other art forms, works in time. And it is a characteristic of temporality that only one thing can be experienced at one time. A performer is someone who will be attuned at a certain moment to one possible meaning. And if he is skillful, he will be able to realize in sound what he is imagining. So what I'm saying really is that if we do understand a piece of music, as I said earlier, in a Platonic way, which can only be imperfectly realized on this earth, we must understand that this is not because there is one perfect way of interpreting a work. It is rather in the sense that any given work offers an infinite number of possibilities, and that the good interpreter is the one who is able to materialize one of the better ones. The same piece played the same way can already have different meanings for different people. Meanings that the composer may or may not have grasped when he was writing it. I will illustrate my case with an interesting piece of music, Saint-Saëns, the Swan, from the Carnival of the Animals. Thank you. It is interesting on many levels. For one thing, it happens to be extremely well known. And it does resonate on an emotional level with most people. But the most interesting thing about it is that it can resonate differently depending on what kind of person you are, or even on what your state of mind was prior to listening to it. You might have found this extract perfectly serene, or maybe you found it nostalgic, or perhaps you found it unbearably sad. Yet the composer, Saint-Saëns, may have had something completely different in mind when he composed it, and could have been deeply surprised to know the effect his melody had on the audience. As a composer, we know he had little interest in the emotional aspects of music. In fact, he rather mistrusted it. What he was looking for was craftsmanship, the beauty of an architecture, the perfection of the form. Yet who could say that we are wrong if we are seeing in the music something the composer may not have perceived? It would be completely meaningless to tell someone who was moved to tears by this the piece that Saint-Saëns didn't particularly want the piece to be moving. Once the music has been composed, it becomes in a way detached from the composer who put it on paper. It becomes an abstraction that can become tangible when it is realized into sound, and it exists every time it is being performed as an independent, unique creation. It might be interesting for us to know what the composer really wanted, although in most cases, as we have seen, this is not possible. But it should perhaps not be taken as a goal, or certainly not as the last word. An interpreter spends on average more time with a piece of music than a composer ever does. I've been, for example, playing some Chopin ballade since I was 13. I'm now 39. I've played it in concert dozens of times. In some levels, it is possible for me to say that I know the piece better than Chopin probably ever did. So it is possible to conceive an interpreter can see in music shades of meanings, possibilities that the composer might never have envisaged, but that he might nevertheless have welcomed it. Or he might not. But again, it doesn't mean that the interpretation has no validity. I will leave you with two anecdotes. The first one concerns Clara Haskell, whom we have already met in this talk. When still a teenager, she played a work by Gabriel Fauré, who heard her interpretation. He said to her, "I didn't know I had put so much in this work, but please do not change a thing." Now the second you may be more familiar with, it concerns Britten. He composed a lot of his music, as is well known, with the voice and personality of Peter Pears in his heart and mind. When he heard his opera, Peter Grimes, sung by the famous Canadian tenor John Vickers, he downright rejected his interpretation. John Vickers simply rejected Britten's rejection on the ground that the work had ceased to belong to Britten alone. So it is difficult for me to propose a conclusion to this talk. For one thing, because I have only brushed on the subject. For another, because I have, as best as I could, consciously tried avoiding projecting too much of my own bias and tried to give you an overview which is not too partisan. What I hope you will take from this is that the interpreter had been regarded with admiration, suspicion, both by the audience and the composers. For some, they are servant, slave even. A contradiction in our modern world, they enjoy such a privileged position that most of the time when we go to a concert, it is not to hear a work being performed. It is to hear a famous musician performing it. So that in a strange reversal of values, the interpreter had become the king and the music the servant. But let us take all these paradoxes as they are, without trying to reach too firm a conclusion. It is, after all, one of the wonders of this profession, that it offers so many different perspectives. If neither composers, nor the audience, nor the interpreters themselves can agree on what the job actually consists of, it is perhaps because interpretation is a reflection of music, and as such, elusiveness is always going to be a part of its nature. Thank you very much. I look forward to meeting you properly, or as properly as can be done, and I will do my best to answer your questions.